So for the last few classes, we have been discussing about the basic notions of digital filter. And in regard to that, we have mentioned that the system property of a digital filter can be best evaluated or can be best described by representing it by means of a system function, that is h of z. And this h of z, as you know, for any LTI system can be written as the ratio of yz to xz. So yz is the z transfer of the output signal yn, and xz is the z transform of the input signal xn. Now this hz can also be represented in rational form like nz upon dz, where nz is known to be the numerator polynomial and dz is known to be the denominator polynomial, nz upon dz. And whenever we consider the filter to be an FIR one, so for FIR filter, the denominator polynomial, that is d of z, is equal to 1. So then we have h of z is equal to nz only. And this nz can be represented in polynomial of z inverse, like we can represent this one like, say, p0 plus p1 z inverse plus p2 z to the power minus 2 plus, say, the last value could have been pm z to the power minus m. So in this case, the highest power of z inverse is known to be capital M, and capital M is known to be the order of the filter. So this is known to be an order M FIR filter. Order M FIR filter. It depends upon the highest power of z inverse. So if hz can be represented in this form, then yz can be written as xz multiplied with this nz. So it's like p0 plus p1z inverse plus p2z to the power minus 2 plus dot dot pmz to the power minus m. So if you take the inverse z transformation, then you can represent y of n as p0 xn plus p1 xn minus 1 plus p2 xn minus 2 plus dot dot pm xn minus m. Now let us consider the input to the system be an unit impulse. That means let us consider that x of n is equal to delta n, which exists only for n is equal to 0, and for other values of n, the value of delta n is equal to 0. So delta n is given by that is equal to 0. I mean, it is equal to 1 for n is equal to 0 and 0 otherwise. So that is the description of the impulse function, unit impulse function. So if this is the input to the system, then you can easily find out what is the value of y of n, that is the impulse response. So you can represent then h of n is equal to, like, so you just put delta n over here instead of x of n. So p0 delta n plus p1 delta n minus 1 plus p2 delta n minus 2 plus dot dot pm delta n minus m. That means this impulse response will exist only for n is equal to 0 to n is equal to capital M. For n is equal to 0, the value is equal to p0. Because in this particular expression, this delta n minus 1, delta n minus 2, delta n minus 3, delta n minus m will be existing only for n is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, dot dot m respectively. Or in other words, this delta n will exist for n is equal to 0. Delta n minus 1 will exist for n is equal to 1. Delta n minus 2 will exist for n is equal to 2, and so on. So therefore, Hn will be equal to P0 for n is equal to 0. This will be equal to P1 for n is equal to 1. This will be equal to P2 for n is equal to 2, and so on. So ultimately, we can write, so this is the complete expression of Hn. Or we can also represent Hn in this form. P0 is the first sample, P1, P2, up to Pm. So obviously, it depends upon the order of the filter. So if the order is m, if it's an m-order FIR filter, so in that case, the length of the impulse response is m plus 1. So the length is m plus 1 for FIR filter. So here we find the length is m plus 1. So if the order is m, then the length is m plus 1. Now, as long as you are considering FIR filter, that means the impulse response is finite in nature. That means m plus 1 is finite. That means m is also finite. So you find that for FIR filter, if you provide the unit impulse at the input of the system, then the response because of that particular input is also finite. The length of the signal is also finite. That means P0, P1, P2 up to Pm. So what about the length? So length is only m plus 1. Now that is only true if the denominator polynomial dz is considered to be 1. So you have only the numerator polynomial. So accordingly, you don't have any feedback connection. And y of n can be represented in a difference equation form by this particular expression. Now, another interesting property which you can observe from this expression is that, so hz can be represented like p0 plus p1z inverse plus p2z to the minus 2 and so on. Now, if I want to represent hz in this particular form like nz by dz, obviously you'll be having the poles and zeros corresponding to that particular FIR filter. Now, until and unless we know the specific values of p0, p1, p2, and pm, so we are not sure about the zero location. So if I want to explain the same thing, so hz is given by nz upon dz, and dz is equal to 1. So I can write like p0 plus p1z inverse plus p2z to the power minus 2 plus pmz to the power minus m. So if I now multiply the numerator and denominator with z to the power m, then it becomes p naught z to the power m plus p1 z to the power m minus 1 plus p2 z to the power m minus 2 plus pm divided by z to the power m, the same thing. So now, until and unless you know the exact value for this P0, P1, P2, you will not be in a position to find out the zero location. Because if you just make this numerator polynomial is equal to zero, then the corresponding roots will give you the zeros of the particular system function. But one thing is very sure, that this particular system function is having m poles at origin. That means if you put z is equal to zero, then obviously hz is unbounded. That means this particular system function will be having poles at the origin. So there are m number of poles. So if I want to show you the corresponding z domain representation, this is the real part of the z, and this will be the imaginary part of the z. This two axis, and let me consider this is the unit circle. So for FIR filter, always the poles will be located at the origin. So you find there are, depending upon the order of the filter, you can have a number of poles. So there are multiple poles exist, but all of them will be existing over here at the origin. Now, since the poles are located inside the unit circle, because the origin is located inside the unit circles, therefore, FIR filter is always stable. Since all the poles are located inside the unit circle, so we are not interested about the zero location, but one thing is very clear, that the poles will be located inside the unit circle. Now, if for any system function, for any arbitrary system function hz, if the poles are located inside the unit circle, then the system function is considered to be, that particular system is considered to be Bebow stable, which is known as the bounded input bounded output stability. That means if I provide a bounded input to the system, then the output will also be bounded. Now that can be guaranteed from the Z domain representation by considering the fact that the poles must be located inside the unit circle. Now that is already guaranteed for a FIR filter. Even if I don't know anything about P0, P1, P2 and all, we know that there will be m number of zeros if the order is m, and all the zeros will be located at the origin, 0, 0 location. That's why the FIR filter is always stable. So the stability is guaranteed. So FIR filter is stable, always stable. And that is one of the biggest advantage of FIR filter, always be boostable over the IIR counterpart. And last day, we have also shown you two different examples for FIR filter, one with the low pass characteristics, another with the high pass characteristics, high pass nature. Now, coming back to the IIR filter, as you know, for IIR filter, if I have once again, I can represent AZ in this form, like NZ upon DZ, but this time DZ is not equal to 1. NZ upon DZ. NZ can also be 1, but DZ cannot be 1. So now you have a form like this. Say P0 plus P1 z to the power minus 1 plus P2 z to the power minus 2 plus Pm z to the power minus m in the numerator. And the denominator you have, say, D0 plus D1 z to the power minus 1 plus D2 z to the power minus 2 plus, say, dn z to the power minus n, where m and n could have been same or it could have been different also. Now here nz can also be 1, but dz cannot be 1. Nz may be equal to 1, or equal to 1, I should not write equal to 1. Nz may be, nz may be equal to 1 or constant, but dz, that is the denominator polynomial, this denominator polynomial is not equal to 1. And for this, we can also define the order of the filter to be the max of m, n. So for example, if I write like az is equal to, say, 1 minus 2z inverse divided by 1 plus 3z to the power minus 2. Then it's a second order IIR filter. Second order IIR filter, because here m is equal to 1 and n is equal to 2. So the max of m comma n will give you the order. So order is given by max of m comma n. Now, if az can be represented in this particular form, then we know that az is given by yz upon xz for LTI system. So this is equal to yz upon xz, and that is equal to nz upon dz. So now if you multiply these two together, so yz multiplied with dz is given by nz or xz multiplied with nz. So that is equal to xz multiplied with nz. Now if you take the inverse z transformation, then what you find is, taking inverse z transformation, what you find is d0yn plus d1yn minus 1 plus dot dot dnyn minus capital N is equal to p0xn plus p1xn minus 1 plus, say, p2xn minus 2 plus dot dot pm x of n minus capital N. So now you find, now if I take this yn in one side, and if I take the other portions, then you have t0 yn is given by minus d1 yn minus 1 plus d2 yn minus 2 plus we have hopefully dn, yes. So dn yn minus capital N plus p0 xn plus p1 xn minus 1 plus pm x of n minus m. So now let us consider that we provide xn is equal to delta n. Once again, the same experiment. The input signal to the system is a simple unit impulse function. But now you see that even if the input signal is having a finite length, that means the length of the impulse function is 1 because it exists only for n is equal to 0. Now, even if the input signal is having a length of 1, but the output, the resultant impulse response is infinite in nature, because when you provide delta n, obviously this d0 hn can be represented as minus d1 hn minus 1 plus d2 hn minus 2 dot dot dn hn minus n plus p0 delta n plus p1 delta n minus 1 plus dot dot pm delta n minus m. Now this part of the equation, this will be existing, this will exist only for n is equal to 0. If you provide x is equal to delta n, this will exist only for n is equal to 1, this will exist for n is equal to 2, and this will exist for n is equal to m. But however, you have already got like y of n minus 1, y of n minus 2 up to y of n minus n. So therefore, as long as you have a feedback from the output side, because the present output y of n is computed from the present input x of n, past input xn minus 1, xn minus 2 up to xn minus n, and the past outputs. For FIR filter, you have seen that. If I just go back to that particular slide, you'll see that for FIR filter, the present output y of n is computed on the basis of the present input x of n and the past input x of n minus 1, x of n minus 2 up to x of n minus m. So there is a limit. So maximum m number of past input samples you are considering plus the present input sample. So that's why the length of the output signal is finite for FIR filter. However, for IR filter, as you can see, the present output signal y of n depends upon the present input, obviously x of n, plus the past input samples x of n minus 1, x of n minus 2 up to x of n minus m, and plus or minus whatever it may be, the past output samples. That means there is a feedback always. So the output at time n is equal to 10 depends upon the output at time n is equal to 9 or n is equal to 8 or n is equal to 7. So therefore, as n progresses, the corresponding output sample or the time instant of the output sample gets modified automatically, and you'll be getting a never ending sequence. And that's why even if the xn is equal to delta n, so hn is having an infinite length. Now, since the impulse response is having an infinite length, although the input, that is impulse function, the unit impulse is finite. I mean, the length of the impulse function is finite, but the impulse response is infinite. So that's why it is known as infinite impulse response filter or IIR filter. Now, considering the system function for any IIR filter, h of z, as I have told you, this is given by nz upon dz form, where dz cannot be a constant. So nz upon dz, so dz is a polynomial of z in Hertz. So therefore, you never know what about the corresponding coefficients, because for FIR filter, you know that this will be always like you have some p0 plus p1 z inverse plus p2 z to the minus 2 plus dot dot pm z to the minus m. So the denominator polynomial is always 1, So if you just multiply the numerator and denominator with z to the power m, so you have only z to the power m in the denominator side. So as a matter of fact, all the poles are located inside the unit circle. In fact, it is located at the origin. Now let us consider a situation like, say, already I've taken an example, I believe. It's like 1 minus 2z inverse plus 1 plus 3z to the power minus 2. So let us consider like this. 1 minus 2z inverse divided by 1 plus 3z to the power minus 2. Now you can represent this one. If I just multiply with z square, then what we get, it will be getting z square minus 2z divided by, you have z square plus 3. So now you can represent this as z into z minus 2 numerator, and in the denominator you have z square plus 3. That means, okay, we can represent like z square plus 3, no problem. So now you have zeros at z is equal to 0 and z is equal to 2. So two real zeros you'll be getting. What about the poles? So poles will be obtained by putting z square is equal to minus 3. So poles are located at, so zeros are at z is equal to 0 and z is equal to 2. And what about the poles? So poles are at z is equal to plus minus root 3 I. Plus minus root 3 I. That means it is completely on the imaginary axis. So let me just show you on the z plane. So this is the real axis of z. So it will be the imaginary axis of z. And we are marking the unit circle like this. Now the zeros are located at z is equal to 0 and z is equal to 2. So we have one zero over here and another zero over here. So there are two zeros. And what about the poles? The poles are located at plus minus root 3 I. That means root 3, you know, that is 1.732. So therefore, if I mark the zeros with some different color, so one pole is located over here and another pole is located over here. So this is minus root 3i and this is plus root 3i. And obviously here the poles are located outside the unit circle. Now since the poles are located outside the unit circle, so the system is not stable, is not Vivo stable. This point is z is equal to 2, this point is origin, that is equal to 2, and this is origin. So now you have the poles located outside the unit circle. Therefore, the system function is not stable. So that completely depends upon the corresponding coefficients. Instead of having 1 plus 3 z to the power minus 2, if I have like 1 plus 0.5 z to the power minus 2 over here, then obviously the poles will be located inside the unit circle. So it depends upon the selection of the coefficients. So if the coefficients are selected properly, then the IR filter can be made stable, but it is not inherently stable. So that is the biggest disadvantage of IR filter over the FIR filter. FIR filter is always stable irrespective of the selection of the coefficients, but IR filter can be selectively made stable. Now with this basic understanding, let us now go to the description of some basic IR digital filters, as we have done also in the last day with FIR one. One was with low pass characteristics, another one with the high pass characteristics. Now, as you know, if I want to have a low pass filter, then obviously it will pass the low frequency component. It will must stop the high frequency components. So therefore, you must be having a zero at the highest frequency present in the frequency axis. So if I just consider an IR filter, IR filter with the low pass characteristics, so IIR low pass filter, IIR low pass filter, Then obviously, since it's a low pass filter, so obviously it will pass the low frequency component and it must stop the high frequency component. And based on our previous day's discussion, you must be knowing that the high frequency present in the digital filter is nothing but omega is equal to pi or z is equal to minus one. That is the highest frequency, because you know that z is given by r e to the power j omega. And from this expression, we can evaluate the frequency characteristics by putting r is equal to 1. So if you put r is equal to 1, you can easily get the Fourier transform from the z transform. In that case, z will become like e to the power j omega. And the highest frequency, so omega is equal to 0, is the lowest frequency, lowest digital frequency, and omega is equal to pi is the highest digital frequency. Irrespective of the analog frequency. Analog frequency can be anything, but depending upon the corresponding sampling rate, the lowest frequency is always zero. That is also true for analog one, and the highest frequency is limited to pi. And then the minimum value for z corresponding to omega equal to zero is equal to one. That corresponds to the low frequency. Low frequency, z is equal to one means low frequency. And z is equal to minus 1 means high frequency, because if you put pi, omega equal to pi over here, e to the power j pi is nothing but cos pi plus j sin pi. Cos pi is minus 1, so it's high frequency. So now, if I would like to design one low pass filter using IIR filter, so obviously I would like to mention with a the simplest architecture, with the simplest possible architecture. Let us consider an IIR filter of order 1, the first order IIR filter. So the thing is that you must put one zero at z is equal to minus 1. So therefore, at z is equal to minus 1, there should be a zero. So if I would like to write h of z in this form, so there should be a zero at z is equal to minus 1. So in the numerator polynomial, it will be in the form of like z plus 1. So if I would like to represent in the form of z inverse, then obviously there will be a term called like 1 plus z inverse. So that should be there in the numerator polynomial. Because if I put z is equal to minus 1 over here, then you'll find that this expression is becoming zero, the numerator part. Then what about the denominator part? Because you must be knowing that since it's not an FIR filter, so you know that for FIR filter, we have put like half into 1 plus Z inverse. And that was considered to be a simple low pass FIR filter. But since it's an IIR filter, so there must be some polynomial in the denominator as well. What I can do is, so you may think that, okay, since at z is equal to 1, that corresponds to low frequency, and since it passes the low frequency component, so can I put 1 minus z inverse in the denominator? Because if I put 1 minus z inverse in the denominator, then obviously at z is equal to 1, you find that this corresponding denominator polynomial is becoming like 0, 1 minus z inverse. If I put like this 1 minus z inverse, let me try like this, 1 minus z inverse, right, 1 minus z inverse. So if I put z is equal to 1 over here, you find that the denominator polynomial is becoming 0, and overall this hz is becoming infinite, because at z is equal to 1, this numerator polynomial will be equal to 2, and the denominator polynomial is becoming 0, so 2 upon 0. So you may consider at z is equal to 1, there is a pole existing, and at z is equal to minus 1, there is a zero existing. It seems fine, but the problem is that with this particular formulation, the pole is located exactly on the unit circle, because this is 1 minus z inverse. So if I put z is equal to 1, then it corresponds to a pole to this particular system function. But you cannot put the pole right exactly on the unit circle, because in that case, the system will be marginally stable or unstable. So instead of putting this one like 1 minus z inverse, what we can do is we can modify this one slightly we can modify this particular thing with a constant, like say 1 minus alpha z inverse, with a condition that mod alpha must be less than 1. Now if 1 minus alpha z inverse is placed in the denominator, then we know that if I put 1 minus alpha z inverse to be 0, then we find that corresponds to z is equal to mod alpha, or rather z is equal to alpha. With z is equal to alpha, this 1 minus z inverse alpha is becoming 0. That means the poles will be existing. So in that case, there is only one pole, single pole, and that pole will exist at z is equal to alpha. Now, if mod alpha is less than 1, obviously it will be located inside the unit circle. Now, if alpha is positive, that means if it is greater than 0, then it should be bounded between 0 to 1. And if it is negative, then it must be bounded between 0 to minus 1. In either case, since the mod alpha value is less than 1, there is no provision that the pole will be located outside the unit circle. It is always located inside the unit circle with this condition. You may consider alpha is equal to 0.5, or you can consider alpha is equal to minus 0.5. But whatever the situation, since mod alpha is less than 1, the pole is always existing inside the unit circle. Now that seems fine, but you can make a slight modification in this particular structure as well. Now, if I put, say, omega equal to 0, which corresponds to z is equal to 1, that is the lowest frequency component. So you find that the numerator is becoming like 2, 1 plus 1, 2, and denominator is like 1 minus alpha only, because with z is equal to 1, this 1 minus alpha z inverse is becoming 1 minus alpha. So now you have 2 by 1 minus alpha. So that is the gain of the system at the lowest frequency, that means at omega equal to 0. Now, in order to normalize this one to 1, so what you can do is we can multiply this overall expression with 1 minus alpha by 2. 1 minus alpha by 2 into 1 plus z inverse upon 1 minus alpha z inverse. Now, this az is having a value equal to 1 at z is equal to 1, that means at the lowest frequency. At z is equal to 1, you have 1 plus 1, 2 over here, and 1 minus alpha over here. So 1 minus alpha by 2 into 2 by 1 minus alpha gets cancelled, and ultimately z is equal to 1 at z is equal to 1. And at what about at z is equal to minus 1? At z is equal to minus 1, you find that here you find it will be like 1 plus alpha, some non-zero component over here in the denominator. This is also non-zero. And what about this one? With z is equal to minus 1, this is becoming 0. So ultimately, z is equal to 0 at z is equal to minus 1. So it satisfies the condition of any low-pass filter. That means the gain should be maximum. It should be 1 at the low frequency component with the lowest frequency. With z is equal to 1, the az value is equal to 1. And with z is equal to minus 1, this az is becoming 0. So it satisfies the two extreme conditions pertaining to any low-pass filter. So now if you are interested in finding out the nature of the frequency response, so what we have done so far is we have just identified the system function, the numerator polynomial and the denominator polynomial, just by putting the poles and zeros at proper locations. And you must be understanding that this particular filter is having an order of 1. So it's the first order IIF filter. Now let us try to investigate whether it is actually showing a low-pass nature or not. So for that, we need to find out the corresponding frequency response. Now, the frequency response can be calculated by putting z is equal to e to the power j omega. So let me once again write down the expression for az. So it is like 1 minus alpha by 2 into 1 plus z inverse divided by 1 minus alpha z inverse. Now, with z is equal to e to the power j omega, we can have 1 minus alpha by 2, 1 plus e to the power minus j omega divided by 1 minus alpha e to the power minus j omega. Now we are interested in finding out h e to the power j omega, the magnitude of that. So we can have slight calculation in the mathematics. So instead of calculating or instead of finding out the modulus of this h e to the power j omega directly from this equation, what we can do is we can also find out h e to the power minus j omega just by putting z is equal to minus j omega e to the power minus j omega. So you have 1 minus alpha by 2, 1 plus e to the power j omega here, 1 minus alpha e to the power j omega here. Now you know h of e to the power minus j omega is also equal to h star, h complex conjugate of e to the power j omega. So these two are same. So now you have this equation. So let me call this as equation number 1. Let me call this as equation number 2. And if I multiply equation 1 with equation 2, then h e to the power j omega and h star e to the power j omega will give you mod of h e to the power j omega whole square. So that is coming like 1 minus alpha whole square upon 4. And then you have 1 plus e to the power minus j omega into 1 plus e to the power j omega divided by 1 minus alpha e to the power minus j omega into 1 minus alpha e to the power j omega. So this is coming like 1 minus alpha whole square upon 4. And now you have 1 plus e to the power j omega into e to the minus j omega will give you another 1. Plus e to the power j omega plus e to the power minus j omega. And here you have 1 plus alpha square minus alpha e to the power j omega minus alpha e to the power minus j omega. So let me go to the next slide. And then mod of h e to the power j omega whole square will give us 1 minus alpha whole square upon 4. And now you have 2 plus e to the power j omega plus e to the power minus j omega in the numerator. And in the denominator, you have 1 plus alpha square and minus alpha e to the power j omega minus alpha e to the power minus j omega. So if I take minus alpha common outside, e to the power j omega plus e to the power minus j omega. Now you know that e to the power j omega plus e to the power minus j omega is nothing but 2 cos omega. So 1 minus alpha whole square by 4 into you have 2 into 1 plus cos omega. And here in the denominator, you have 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha cos omega. And that is equal to 1 minus alpha whole square by 2 into 1 plus cos omega divided by 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha cos omega. Now once again you can check that with omega equal to 0, that means with z is equal to 1, you can find this mod of h to the power j omega whole square is becoming 1. And with omega equal to pi, that is z is equal to minus 1, this mod of h to the power j omega whole square is becoming 0. So now, if you would like to know what about the the nature of this particular magnitude response, which is known to be the squared magnitude response, only we know about the value of this mod h to the power j omega whole square mod d square at omega equal to zero. You can verify that value is, if I put omega equal to zero, so cos zero is nothing but one, so 1 plus 1 2 2 by 2, that is 1 minus alpha whole square. Here also cos omega equal to 1, so 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha, that is equal to 1 minus alpha whole square. So mod h to the power j omega whole square is equal to 1, that is fine. And at omega equal to pi, that is the highest frequency component, so you have cos pi is equal to minus 1, so obviously this mod of h to the power j omega whole square is becoming 0. So now we are interested in knowing the nature of the variation of this mod h to the power j omega whole squared magnitude function with respect to frequency. So that can be readily obtained if I find out the corresponding derivative of this one, this expression, with respect to the frequency. So let me just consider the expression once again. That is equal to 1 minus alpha whole square by 2 and you have 1 plus cos omega and 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha cos omega. So if I would like to find out the derivative of this, then it is given by 1 minus alpha square by 2. You can take it outside. 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha cos omega whole square. And then 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha cos omega. This entire thing gets multiplied with the derivative of 1 plus cos omega. For 1 it is constant, that is 0, and for cos omega it is nothing but minus of sine omega. Minus you have 1 plus cos omega and 1 plus alpha square, that is a constant part, and you have 2 alpha sine omega. So let me just, I think that is coming outside the margin. Into 2 alpha sine omega. So then this value is 1 minus alpha whole square by 2 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha cos omega whole square. And now you have plus 2 alpha cos omega sine omega here and minus 2 alpha cos omega sine omega here. So that gets cancelled and we are left with 1 plus alpha square into minus sine omega and minus 2 alpha sine omega. So you can have a minus sign outside with 1 plus alpha square plus 2 alpha into sine omega. So in a better sense, we can put this minus sign outside. So we can put this minus sign outside. One minus alpha whole square divided by two. So that is all about the variation of the squared magnitude response with respect to frequency. Now you know the range of the frequency is obviously limited within 0 to pi. So omega is limited between 0 to pi. And within that range, what about the value of sine omega? That is always positive, the first and second quadrant. Sine omega is always positive. And this 1 plus alpha square plus 2 alpha is nothing but 1 plus alpha whole square. And what about this one? 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha cos omega. Now with omega equal to 0, that is nothing but 1 minus alpha whole square. And with omega equal to pi, that is 1 plus alpha whole square. So both these terms, like 1 minus alpha whole square, 1 plus alpha whole square, sine omega, so all these terms are positive. And sine omega is also positive in the first quadrant from 0 to pi. So all these terms, 1 minus alpha whole square by 2 into this one. So the entire expression, so if I would like to contain this entire thing with by means of this bracket, you'll find that the entire terms within the bracket is always positive within that particular range, 0 to pi. However, you will be having a minus sign outside. What does it mean? Within this range, 0 to pi, this derivative of the squared magnitude response with respect to frequency is always negative, because this term is always positive, this term is always positive, irrespective of the value of the alpha. So this is always positive, this term, and you have minus sign here. So that means the derivative of this with respect to frequency is always non-positive or negative. That means it suggests that this particular square magnitude response will be reduced as omega increases. Or in other words, it can validate the monotonically decreasing behavior of the magnitude function. So now you can find out the expression for the cutoff frequency. And last day, so before going into the cutoff frequency, so let me just tell you how does it look like. It's omega, and this one is say mod of h e to the power j omega whole square. So it will be something like that. So obviously it will depend upon the value of the alpha. The corresponding roll off is heavily dependent upon the value of alpha, and it is very difficult to draw by hand. If you have some simulator, then you can plot this mod h e to the power j omega for different values of alpha. But in any case, the behavior will be something like that. It will decrease monotonically as the frequency increases from 0 to pi. Now, if you would like to find out the corresponding, the cutoff frequency, the 3 dB cutoff frequency, at which point this mod of h to the power j omega whole square is equal to half, that you can readily do by considering that particular expression, this one. What you have got, 1 minus alpha whole square by 2, 1 plus cos omega by 1 plus alpha square by minus 2 alpha cos omega. So this is the expression for the squared magnitude response. Now if I equate this expression with equal to half, then it becomes the corresponding frequency component is nothing but the 3 dB cutoff frequency. So let me do that calculation. So mod h to the power j omega whole square, what you have got is 1 minus alpha whole square by 2. You have 1 plus cos omega and 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha cos omega. Now I have to equate this one to half, and then the cutoff frequency is equal to omega c, where omega c is the cutoff frequency. So this one, 1 minus alpha whole square into 1 plus cos omega c, that is equal to 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha cos omega c. So this one is nothing but 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha plus cos omega c plus alpha square cos omega c minus 2 alpha cos omega c. And this side you have 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha cos omega c. So 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha cos omega c gets cancelled, and we are left with alpha square minus 2 alpha plus alpha square cos omega c to be equal to 0. No, I think alpha square gets cancelled. So alpha square gets cancelled, so it's not alpha square. Let me just cancel out. So 1 alpha square 2 alpha cos omega c, so they're getting cancelled, and you are left with alpha square cos omega c plus cos omega c is equal to 2 alpha. So if you take cos omega c common, then it becomes twice alpha by 1 plus alpha square. And from that, the omega c can be calculated, the corresponding cutoff frequency to be cos inverse 2 alpha by 1 plus alpha square. So depending upon the value of alpha, the value of this cutoff frequency can be tuned. Or in other words, if you'd like to fix the corresponding value of the cutoff frequency, suppose you'd like to design the IR filter with a cutoff frequency, say, at pi by 4. So in that case, what you can do is, we can also find out the value of alpha from this expression, because this is the governing expression. The governing expression says that alpha square cos omega c minus 2 alpha plus cos omega c is equal to 0. Now suppose omega c is given to you and you are asked to find out the value of alpha so that the corresponding design requirements can be met off. So in that case, you can find out the value of alpha as minus b, so minus b plus minus b squared, that is 4, minus 4ac, so 4 cos squared omega c upon 2 cos omega c. So 2 plus minus, that is equal to 2 plus minus 2 sine omega c divided by 2 cos omega c. So let me go to the next slide. This says that alpha is given by 1 plus minus sine omega c by cos omega c. So alpha is given by 1 plus minus sine omega c upon cos omega c. So given a particular value of omega c, let it be pi by 4 or pi by 2, whatever it may be. Now you have two different values of alpha because you have solved this using this quadratic equation. So obviously you'll be having two different values for alpha. But now in order to select the particular value of alpha which can make the system stable, you have to make this alpha to be 1 minus sine omega c upon the cos omega c, because this value of alpha will make the system stable, because in that case the mod alpha is guaranteed to be less than 1. Otherwise, if I select 1 plus sine omega c divided by cos omega c, then the numerator will be greater than 1 and the denominator is less than 1, so the resultant ratio is always greater than 1. And our primary condition that the alpha should be, or mod alpha should be, less than 1, so that condition cannot be satisfied. So in order to make the IR filter stable, So I have to select the minus sign over here and the perfect solution for the value of alpha over here is 1 minus sine omega c upon cos omega c. So this particular structure, this 1 plus z inverse divided by 1 minus alpha z inverse multiplied with 1 minus alpha by 2 will make a low pass IIR filter. Now, if I carry out the same thing with the high pass nature, so let me just consider the high pass IIR filter. So in that case, the requirement will be just opposite. So for high pass filter, you must be knowing that there should be a zero at z is equal to 1. At z is equal to 1, so if I would like to go back here, so for low pass filter, you have seen that at z is equal to 1 or at the lowest frequency, there should be a corresponding gain, but at the high frequency, the gain must be equal to 0. That means at z is equal to minus 1, there was a 0 for IIR low pass filter. But here, since we are designing the high pass filter, so at z is equal to plus 1, that means at the lowest frequency, there should be a 0. So instead of having 1 plus z inverse, now we should be having like 1 minus z inverse. So that at z is equal to 1, there is a 0. And it means that the lowest frequency component gets completely attenuated by virtue of that particular filter. So you have like 1 minus z inverse here. And if I just replicate the denominator side, so instead of having 1 minus alpha z inverse over here, okay, let me just first fix the numerator polynomial. So instead of having 1 plus z inverse, now you must be having 1 minus z inverse. That is fine. So that at z is equal to 1, there is a 0. That means it confirms the requirement of a high pass nature. Now, in the denominator, we have previously 1 minus alpha z inverse. Now, if I put like 1 minus alpha z inverse here also in the denominator, and at z is equal to 1, obviously, the entire expression is becoming 0 because the numerator polynomial is becoming 0. At z is equal to plus 1, now what happens at z is equal to minus 1? We must ensure that at z is equal to minus 1, the gain provided by the circuit should be the maximum because it is showing the high pass nature. So at z is equal to minus 1, what about this particular value, 1 minus alpha z inverse? This is becoming 1 plus alpha. And this numerator is becoming 2 at z is equal to minus 1. So if I would like to normalize this one, what I can do is, last time we have multiplied this expression with 1 minus alpha by 2, and this time we have to multiply this one with 1 plus alpha by 2. Now you can check that at z is equal to plus 1, hz is becoming 0. Because the nz, this numerator polynomial, is becoming 0. And at z is equal to minus 1, which corresponds to the highest frequency component, what about az? So this is equal to 2, 1 minus z inverse. This is becoming 1 plus alpha. So 2 by 1 plus alpha multiplied with 1 plus alpha by 2. Then ultimately, it becomes 1. So it confirms the high pass response requirements. Once again, the order of the filter is equal to 1. and you can readily find out the input and output relationship. So if I consider that h of z is equal to some constant k multiplied with 1 minus z inverse by 1 minus alpha z inverse, and that is equal to say yz upon xz, then in the inverse z domain, what you can write is kxn minus kxn minus 1 kxn minus kxn minus 1 is equal to yn minus alpha yn minus 1. So yn can be written as kxn minus kxn minus 1 plus alpha yn minus 1. That means the present output sample depends upon the present input sample xn plus the previous or past input sample and the past output sample. So obviously it demonstrates the behavior of an IR filter, and the high pass requirements can be obtained from this one, that with z is equal to 1, az is becoming 0, and with z is equal to minus 1, az is becoming 1. Now if you would like to find out the frequency response pertaining to this circuit or this particular system function, you can do the same exercise what you have done few minutes back. That means you have to put z is equal to e to the power j omega. You need to put z is equal to e to the power j omega in order to find out. So already you have got like h of z like 1 plus alpha by 2 multiplied with 1 minus z inverse by 1 minus alpha z inverse. So put z is equal to e to the power j omega, you can get h e to the power j omega. Find out the expression, that means 1 plus alpha by 2 multiplied with 1 minus e to the power minus j omega divided by 1 minus alpha e to the power minus j omega. Similarly, you can find out the expression for h of e to the power minus j omega, which is also equal to h star of e to the power j omega, and that can be obtained like 1 plus alpha by 2 1 minus e to the power j omega divided by 1 minus alpha e to the power j omega. So if I call this to be equation number 1, this to be equation number 2, you need to multiply 1 and 2 in order to obtain h e to the power j omega whole square. You can find out the expression. Almost the same calculation. So 1 plus alpha whole square by 4. And then you have 1 minus e to the power minus j omega, 1 minus e to the power j omega. So now you'll be having, last time you have 1 plus cos omega. Now this time you should be having like 1. There'll be 2 outside, 1 minus cos omega. The same thing. And in the denominator, you have 1 minus alpha e to the minus j omega, 1 minus alpha e to the power plus j omega. So 1 plus alpha square. And then the rest of the part will be remaining as it is. Last time we have same thing, 1 minus alpha z inverse. So the denominator will not be modified. So 1 minus 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha cos omega. So this is equal to 1 plus alpha whole square upon 2, 1 minus cos omega divided by 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha cos omega. So h of e to the power j omega mod square is given by 1 plus alpha whole square divided by 2. And in the numerator, you have 1 minus cos omega instead of 1 plus cos omega last time. And 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha cos omega in the denominator. Now you can check with omega equal to 0. What we find is mod h to the power j omega whole square, because cos 0 is 1, so 1 minus 1 0, that is becoming 0. And with omega is equal to pi, that is the highest frequency, is mod h e to the power j omega whole square is becoming, so cos pi is minus 1, so 1 minus or minus 1, that is 2. 2 by 2, that is getting cancelled. 1 plus alpha square here and 1 plus alpha square plus 2 alpha. That is, once again, 1 plus alpha whole square. So that is 1. So it's a high plus nature. So high plus behavior. And if you'd like to find out the cutoff frequency, so this will be nothing but 1 plus alpha whole square by 2 into 1 minus cos omega, divided by 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha cos omega c, if omega c is the cutoff frequency, that is equal to half. So then 1 plus alpha whole square into 1 minus cos omega c is equal to 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha cos omega c. So from that, what you can find is 1 plus alpha square plus 2 alpha minus cos omega c minus alpha square cos omega c minus 2 alpha cos omega c is equal to 1 plus alpha square minus 2 alpha cos omega c. So once again, we are getting almost the same expression, hopefully. 1 alpha square and 2 alpha cos omega c can be cancelled, and we are left with 2 alpha minus is equal to alpha square cos omega c plus cos omega c. So we are left with 2 alpha is equal to 1 plus alpha square into cos omega c. 1 plus alpha square into cos omega c. So from that, we can find out the expression for cos omega c to be 2 alpha upon 1 plus alpha square. So the same expression what you have got last time. And similarly, you can find out the value of alpha to be 1 minus sine omega c upon cos omega c. So this completes the design of the high pass IIR filter. Since you have the IIR filter in this particular discussion, so obviously, apart from a numerator polynomial, you must be having a denominator polynomial as well. And these are the requirements of any high pass characteristics. The system function should exhibit a value of 0 at the lowest frequency component, and it should exhibit a value of 1 at the highest frequency components. So that is guaranteed from this particular expression of the system function. And the cutoff frequency you can get directly from this expression. So just by tuning the value of alpha, you can modify the value of the cutoff frequency. And if the cutoff frequency is fixed for your design requirements, then for this particular value of the cutoff frequency, you can find out the corresponding value of alpha. So with this, I would like to complete the discussion on this particular unit on digital filter. And moreover, this also completes our discussion in this particular course on electronic system design.